Software engineers spend a lot of time working with lists. You work on Wall Street. You're analyzing lists of stock prices. Writing software for a drone delivery service. You're processing lists of orders. You work at Friendface. You're profiling lists of users with your mountain of personal data. A lot of code is spent analyzing, filtering, and combining the items in a list. Python gives you functions to streamline these tasks, the map, filter, and reduce functions. We will now iterate over this list of functions, one by one. Let us begin with the map function. Suppose we have a function that computes the area of a circle with radius r. What if we need to compute the areas for many different circles? Here is a list of their radii. One way to do this would be to first create an empty list of areas. Next, you could loop over the list of radii. For each radius, you would compute the area of the circle, then append it to the area list. This block of code is very clear and direct. But with the map function, we can accomplish this with a single line of code. The map function takes two arguments. The first is a function, and the second is your list, tuple, or other iterable object. Here, map will apply the area function to each element in the list. But look, the output of the map function is not a list. It is a map object, which is actually an iterator over the results. This is highly favorable, especially when working with large collections of data. We can, however, turn this into a list by passing the map to the list constructor. If brevity is the soul of wit, then Python is in a class by itself. Here is the general way the map function works. Suppose you have a list, tuple, or other iterable collection of data, and we would like to apply the function f to each piece of data. With the map function, you first specify the function, then you specify the data to iterate over. The map function will return an iterator over the collection of f applied to each piece of data. For a second example, we will use the map function when working with data for a map. Suppose you work for a weather reporting service, and all of your temperature data is stored in Celsius. Then, unexpectedly, someone asks for a weather map in Fahrenheit. How could this happen? I just do not know. Nevertheless, we live to serve the user. Here is a list of temperature data for some major cities around the world. Each tuple contains the name of the city in English and the temperature in degrees Celsius. Our goal is to convert this to a list where the degrees are in Fahrenheit. Here is the formula for converting from Celsius to Fahrenheit. First, we will write a converter function using a lambda expression. This function will accept a tuple as the input and will return a tuple with the same name, but the temperature in Fahrenheit. If you are unfamiliar with lambda expressions, they are a way to create short functions in a single line. We have a video that covers this topic in detail. You can now create a list of data in Fahrenheit by mapping the converter function to our list of temperature data. Do not forget your jacket if you are visiting Argentina. The filter function is used to select certain pieces of data from a list, tuple, or other collection of data. This name was chosen because it filters out the data you do not need. Suppose you are analyzing some data, and you would like to select all values that are above the average. First, import the statistics module, since it contains the mean function. Here is a short list of data that I collected from a nearby fuel sensor. Let us compute the average of this data. Then display the average so that you can see that the filter works as intended. We will now use the filter function to select the data greater than the average. Just like with map, the first argument is a function. We will create an anonymous function that tests the input to see if it is above average. Next, pass in the list of data. The filter function will only return the data for which the function is true. Once again, the return value is not a list, but a filter object, which is an iterator over the results. We can create a list of the results by passing the filter function to the list constructor. It worked. These are the three values above the mean. And with a small change to the lambda expression, you can select the values below average. I should check the sensor. We cannot have negative amounts of fuel, can we? Let us see another interesting use of the filter function. When you are working with data from outside sources, you will often encounter missing data or empty values. For example, here is a partial list of the countries in South America. Notice there are numerous strings that are empty. To remove these, we'll use the filter function, but instead of passing in a function, we'll simply pass none as the first argument. The second argument is the list of data as before. This filters out all values that are treated as false in a Boolean setting. In Python, The values that are treated as false are the empty string, zero, an empty list, empty tuple, empty dictionary, false, none, and those objects that signal to Python that it is a trivial instance. But be careful when using the filter function in this way. Zero is a valid piece of data in most situations, so you would not want to filter that out. The last function on our list is the reduce function. This function is a bit unusual. In fact, as of Python 3, it is no longer a built-in function. Instead, it has been demoted to the functools module. The creator of Python had this to say about the reduce function. Use functools.reduce if you really need it. However, 99% of the time an explicit for loop is more readable. Once you see an example of the reduce function, you are likely to agree. Here is how the reduce function works. Suppose you have a sequence of data, and a function that takes two arguments. The reduce function will first apply f to the first two terms. Next, it will apply f to the output value and to the third piece of data. Then, it will repeat this process. In each step, it applies f to the previous output value and the next term in the sequence. Once it has reached the last piece of data, it will return the final value. Alternatively, the reduce function computes this nested value. Let us see an example. To use the reduce function, we must first import it from the functools module. Let us use the reduce function to multiply all numbers in a list. For this demonstration, we will multiply the first 10 prime numbers. To use the reduce function, we need a function that takes two inputs. We will use a lambda expression to make a function that will multiply the two inputs. And there is the product. Here is how it would look if you multiply the prime numbers using a for loop instead of the reduce function. Which do you prefer? The map, filter, and reduce functions greatly simplify the process of working with lists and other iterable collections of data. In fact, if you use lambda expressions, your work can often be done in a single line. After you master these functions, you will realize that Python should be a comedian, because it's full of one-liners.